Good morning, Cornerstone family. Thank you so much for joining us for our Sunday morning service on our online platforms. So if you're tuning in from YouTube, Facebook, welcome and thank you so much for being part of this fellowship. Truly, we are expecting God for greater things. We are expecting God that our tomorrow is better than our today. And we look forward with anticipation because God is in control. And more than that, God is on the move. And when God moves, people move. I am so excited to bring you guys the Word of God this morning. We are starting a very new series titled, In Your Mind, In Your Life. And for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be looking at renewing your mind. And I'm just going to show you from a couple of passages in the scripture why this is so important and what does it mean for you to transform your life and what does it mean for you to change your mind and change your future. First of all, I just want to thank everybody that's been watching these videos and has subscribed on our YouTube channel and liked our page on Facebook. Thank you so much for your support. Thank you for being part of our family. And thank you so much for just commenting and sharing and liking and doing everything possible to stay connected with the life of the church. We love you. We appreciate you. Even though we cannot be with you physically, thank you so much for welcoming us in your home to be with you digitally. So, we're going to do this great teaching and I'm excited about it. I hope you got your Bibles ready. I hope you're excited to hear the Word of God this morning because it's going to be awesome. It's going to be awesome. And my sub-theme for today is, what do you mind? What do you mind? And you'll understand that a little bit better as we go on. But if you're writing down, you can just write our theme for the month is, In Your Mind, In Your Life. And the sub-theme for today's message is, what do you mind? Can we pray real quickly? Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your presence that transcends all geographic location and limitations. Lord, we thank you that you are as much here as you are in the people's homes. We thank you, Lord God, that you are for us, you love us, you'll never leave us, and you'll never forsake us. I pray that you speak into our lives this morning. I pray that we'll never be the same again. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, firstly, before I go into the Word of God, I just want to summarize what church looks like for us as Cornerstone Northside. Perhaps because of everything that has been happening, we don't really know what it means for us to be in church during this season, to be part of a family and a fellowship of believers. And we need to adjust, we need to evolve with the changes that are happening with the lockdown regulations. So I just want to just let you guys know where you are and where you stand. You can see yourself, how you can get more involved and how can you actually be part of a fellowship, unlike just watching stuff online. So in simple, if you've done our Get Plugged program, it's basically a program where we get to introduce you to the life of the church and who we are and what we believe. So there's these main statements that we say, which have pretty much become like our mission statement, which is to belong, grow, and reach. And that's what we like to do. And we aim to this Cornerstone Northside. We want to make sure that everybody belongs. We want to make sure that everybody grows. And furthermore, that everybody reaches other people. So you come in and you belong as part of a community, part of a body, part of a family. And then you must grow in that family, in that group. And more than that, you must grow so that you can reach others as well for Jesus. So how does this look like in our digital platform today, in our digital world where we are under restrictions, where we cannot meet? So in simple, to belong simply means you're connected in our social media platforms. So if you have not yet subscribed on our channel, please subscribe on our channel. If you haven't liked our page on YouTube, to like our page and follow us on Instagram. That will just help you to belong because that means you are connected with us whenever we have specific information that we need to let you know and keep you posted with what's happening in the life of the church, in relative with what's happening in the world. Those social media platforms is how we communicate with you. So to belong right now just simply means being part or networking with us as Cornerstone Northside Online in all these different platforms. And then how do you grow? You belong, you've done that, if you've subscribed, if you can tick that box. But now how do you grow? Virtual connect groups, virtual prayer connect. So we have connect groups happening on Tuesdays and Thursdays. We are meeting on our WhatsApp groups. If you're not part of a virtual connect group, you can plug yourself in one today. You can just let us know and we'll put you and we'll plug you into one that is closest to where you stay. And then lastly is to reach. Help us reach people by giving. The one way to reach, once you've belonged, you've connected on social media, you've growing by connecting on being part of one of our virtual connect groups, and also joining us for our Zoom prayer meetings every Friday. The one way that you can help us to reach people, you can reach people, is simply by continuing to be faithful with your tithes and offering. Just by keeping those simple principles, you're actually doing a lot. As a church, we are embarking on a couple of programs and activities to help those who are in need, affected by this lockdowns, loss of income, loss of jobs, and how we can help within our community and our neighboring communities. So whenever you're giving into the church, you are actually giving to a greater initiative. So please help us to reach more people for Jesus during this season by just being faithful with tithing, even when it's not easy, and giving financially to the life of the church. So make sure that you belong, and make sure that you grow, and make sure that you are reaching people. Make sure that you belong, make sure that you are growing, make sure that you are reaching people. I think these fundamental things are actually what are pivotal in your Christian walk and in your Christian journey. And as Cornerstone Northside, we are helping to facilitate those so that you don't lose sight of who you are and what it means to be a Christian, to belong, to grow, and to reach. Well, let's get right into it. Today, we're talking about what do you mind? And we're going to be reading the book of Romans, chapter number 8. But the background of the story is in chapter number 7, Paul is actually talking about some of the struggles that he was facing. And he was talking about the fact that he had a power that was in him that was making him do the things that he didn't want to do. And maybe you can relate to what Paul is saying in one way or another. It's in Romans chapter number 7, verse number 18. For I know that in me that is in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but the sin that dwelleth in me. He is here in a predicament where he wants to do the right thing, but somehow just does not have the power to do what he wants to achieve, to do what he has given himself to do. He says, I want to be this. I want to change my life. I want to be better. I want to love the good things. I want to do righteous. I want to love people. I want to forgive. You know, there's that thing that you know what's right and you want to do it, but somehow you just don't have the power to do the right thing. And even worse than that, you end up doing the things that you hate. So for instance, you continue lying, you continue in lust, you continue in fornication, you continue in your pride and your wrath and all of these things that are negative and are affecting you negatively and your future. Paul was just like you in that regard. He had some evil habits and things that he didn't want to do and wouldn't even probably mention in public that he was struggling with. And as you are struggling, we are saying that there is hope for you. If you continue here in chapter number 7, in the last two verses, in verse number 24, he says, O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death? Now here is Paul. He is saying to us in the book of Romans chapter number 7 that he wants to do the right, but he doesn't find the power in him to do the right that he wills to do. But even more than that, he finds himself doing the evil that he hates to do. Then he says, it is no longer I who does it is what I find, but the sin that lives in me. And maybe you can relate to that in some way or another, where you feel like you're no longer in control of your own life. You end up doing things regardless of your tenacious will to not do them, but you find yourself repeating the evil that you hate. Paul was just like you, and he's crying out in this verse, who shall deliver me from this body of death, the body of sin, which means I am doomed. I cannot save myself. I would love my life to be better. I would love to live differently, but there's just something in me that just keeps holding me back. I see my relationship with God going a lot more different than it is. I see my relationship with people going a lot more different than it is. But there is something different that just keeps making me do the same mistakes over and over again. And you end up going in circles because it's one step forward, two steps back. And if that is you, there is hope for you, because that the book of Romans does not end in chapter number 7. In fact, chapter number 8 has some really good news for you, which is going to be the core of my preaching, or rather teaching, this morning. So Romans chapter number 8, verse number 1. For there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. So Paul is saying to us that before I had no power because the sin was ruling in my life, and therefore I was doomed because I had no power over the sin which was controlling me. Everything that I was doing was not me but the sin. But now God sent his Son to punish the sin that is doing these things inside of me. So all of a sudden there's a shift of powers. There's a shift of authority. There's a shift of ability. Now it's no longer the sin that is in control, but it is Jesus who's in control. Now it's no longer evil that's in control, but it's righteousness that's in control, because God sending his Son dethroned sin in my life. Which means the sin has no body in my life. It cannot reign in me. Man, that is good news, because I do not have to be addicted to sin anymore. I don't have to lie anymore and say I cannot help it. Yes, I can, when I am saved and born again through the redeeming blood of Jesus Christ. So when Jesus died on the cross, it was actually sin dying on the cross, because he took upon himself the sin of the world. That's why in Isaiah chapter number 53 it says, and it pleased God to crush him, because he was punishing sin in mankind. So it was important for Jesus to become a man so that he can embody himself with the flesh that has imprisoned man for a long time. And so destroying the thing that was imprisoning man, he may free man by him becoming like the people he has come to redeem. I'm not sure if you're understanding what I'm saying, but it's very important to understand the significance and the mystery behind a God becoming flesh. It was more about him taking our place so that we can take his place. So he had to be identical to us so that he can take the shame that we bear. So all the powers of sin and everything that has happened in your past has no power over you through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Can I just say and exclaim as loud as I can through that screen, through that phone, wherever you are watching from, that past has no power over you when you give your life to Jesus Christ. The sin has no power over you when you give your life to Jesus Christ. Because when you give your life to him, automatically everything that has bound you dies with him on the cross, and you become what we call a new creature. As he is, so are we in this world. So in his righteousness, in his fullness, in his authority and power over death and sin is where you stand. And actually what it means is that you are untouchable because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And that's the good news, that by grace we are saved and we no longer have to be a slave to fear and to sin. So whether it's COVID-19 or no COVID-19, fear is not our portion, just because we know who we are. We know whose we are. And he continues, chapter number 8, verse number 4, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh but after the Spirit. Now, all of a sudden, it is no longer the sin that is living in us, but it's the righteousness that lives in us, because there's been a shift of power. There's been a shift of life. There's been a beautiful exchange. It's no longer the sin that's in charge, but Christ is in charge. And therefore, we have the victory. For they that are after the flesh, now listen to this, do mind the things of the flesh, What do you mind? Those that are of the flesh do mind the things that are of the flesh. The word mind also means to set affections on. Do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are of the spirit, the things of the spirit. What do you mind? What you mind determines how you live. Your life is a replica of your mind. Your mind is expressed in your action. What do you mind? Those who mind the things of the spirit will follow the things of the spirit, but those who mind the things of the flesh will follow the things of the flesh. So is your mind in the things of this world, in the materialistic things of this world, in money, fame, and pride, and vanity, and all the lust and everything that's going on in this world? Is that where your mind is? Or is in your mind in the things of God, in the gifts of the Spirit, in the fruit of the Spirit, in love, joy, peace, happiness, self-control, and loving people, and just being laborious and being there for people and laboring for God? Where is your mind? Man, I love this text, because it's very important you understand why you must answer that question. And if you're writing down, write that down. What do you mind? And just maybe make it personal. What do I mind? What's on my mind? What consumes my mind? What do I spend my time thinking about most of the day? Because what you spend your mind thinking about is what's going to rule your life. Listen, this is why it's important. Chapter number 8, verse 6. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Man, to be carnally minded is death. So if you have answered the box and you actually realize that in your mind, there's a lot of earthly, worldly things, he says that mindset is actually death. And that's why we find a lot of people ending up committing suicide and dying an early death, simply because the mind died way before they killed themselves. Because the mind in itself was filled with carnality, with the passions of this world, with things that do not please God. And when you die in your mind, you die in your life. You can be living but dead. You are a walking corpse. But if you mind the things of the spirit, those who are spiritually minded have life and peace. The only way to have peace in your life, to set your mind on things that are above, to set your mind on things that God says about you, to set your mind on the promises of God, to set your mind on His word. If you're healthy in your mind, you're healthy in your body. The mind is very important, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. They that are in the flesh cannot please God. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit, if so that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. If you continue to walk and follow things of this world and look into fleshly ambitions, it is impossible for you to please God. It is important for you to be able to change your mind, what's on your mind, so that you can please God. Just remove the fear. That the biggest problem about this COVID-19 thing is the fear that it brings to people. So actually people are affected before they even infected. The fear of getting the disease has become more serious or detrimental to people more than actually being infected. But if you change what you set your mind on, the things that God has placed for us, we are the redeemed of the Lord. We are the ones who bear the righteousness of God. If you set your mind and your heart on the things that are above, you will live a healthier life. So change your thinking. Change your mind and change your life. If you cannot change your mind, you will not change your life. And if you've always envisioned a better future, a more prosperous future, a better relationship with God, a better relationship with His church, a better relationship with His word, you need to start by changing your mind. Now you're asking me, and this is the response part of this message, how do I change my mind? I want to change my life, and I realize to change my life, I need to change my mind. I want to live a better life. I want to have a better future. I want to change my mind today. How do I do it? Well, this gives us a hint in the book of Romans chapter number 12, which is the last verse that I'm going to be reading. Verse number 2. And be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Do not be conformed, which means don't be like them. Don't look up to them. You have a different blueprint. You have a different vision. You are a different species. You're not just a mere man. What amuses you needs to be different to what amuses the world. Your pleasures are different. The things that interest you should be different, because you are of a different type of breed. You are the God kind. So he says, do not be conformed to this world. Don't think like the world. Don't have the same way of dealing with things like the world. Have a different approach. Your life must be an ambient of the kingdom that you represent. So you gotta have a different perception in the way you're dealing with the world. Do not be conformed to the image of this world. So we need to really see from your life that you are not part of this world. Do not be conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, the first question was, what do you mind? Now, you know what you mind and you want to change that. Now, the second question is, how do you change what's on your mind? Right? Simple. Input equals output. Input equals output. The only way to change your mind is to change your input. So whatever you see and whatever you hear is what comes into your mind. Everything that's in your mind has gotten through your ears and eyes, right? Everything that you know is based on what you've seen and what you've heard. So the only way to change your thinking is to change your input. You need to change from today on with the thing that you spend time doing, listening to, and seeing. What are you watching? What music are you listening to? What kind of people are you hanging around with? What kind of conversations are you having? The only way to change your life is to change your mind. The only way to be transformed is to be renewed. So renew your mind to change your future. If you don't want to remain where you are, I know for a fact I don't want to remain where I am. I know that God has got much and better and greater things for me. So I continually have to be in a journey of unlearning so that I can learn the new things. There's a system of a world that indoctrinates us through social media, advertising, and all of these things that are happening to try and make us to think a certain way. But then there's the Word of God as well that wants us to think a certain way. The question is, which way are you thinking? What do you mind? If you are being honest with yourself, are you part of the world in your thinking? Materialistic, fame, pride, money, all the ambitions and passions of the world, do those things determine your happiness? Is that where you put your affection? Is that where your mind is? Can I tell you that if that is your life, you are death, because to be carnally minded is death. So if you want to put your affection for that, you truly will never have inner joy and peace. But if you want to really live life to its fullest beyond what money and anything in this world can give you, you've got to set your heart and your mind on the things that are above, the things of the Spirit, because through them you receive life and peace. So when you change what you input, you change what you output. You will live as a result of what you eat. Your body reflects what you put inside of it, and your life is a result of your mind. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. A man speaks out of the abundance of the heart. The meditations of your heart have a lot to say with your future and with your life. Whatever you do is a result of that. Sometimes you probably have said something like, but why did I say that? Well, it's an indication of what's in your heart. If you want to be a better person, if you want to be closer to God, if you want to live better for Jesus, you've got to change your thinking. Now, that is my response. That's my word for you today. And for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be developing this theme, and we're going to be dealing with the psyche, because one of the things that the devil has done to rob us is to distract us. The mind is distracted. You see, the mind is like the sun, and the rays like the focus. It is only as powerful as its concentration. The more you concentrate on something, is the more you grow, the more powerful the sun is. When you take a magnifying glass and you put on the object, and there's a sun above, that's when you get more heat transferred on that object. because you have narrowed down the focus. And that's what we need to do. We need to focus our minds on the things that are above. And the enemy tries to distract you, because without focus, your mind cannot become powerful. But if you focus on the things that are above and not be distracted by the miniature things of this world that are coming on your phone, the alerts, the messages, the whatnot, as so many things are happening in this world that are coming to take your focus. Look, you need to select what you watch, select the news that you watch, select the entertainment that you select, everything that you do, so that you don't lose focus. The biggest thing right now, I think, that is really stopping the church from being effective is loss of focus. The mind is not at the right place. It's not engaged in the right things. So the loss of focus is a loss of effectiveness. It's a loss of power. So for us to regain the focus and the power, we've got to change our input. Change your input, you change your output. So interrogate what you do with your time from this day onward. Look, this is not supposed to be just another sermon. There's so many things that are being said out there. This is not just supposed to be another preaching for the sake of having a message on Sunday. No, this is supposed to challenge you so that you will not be disqualified. This is supposed to help you interrogate yourself that throughout this lockdown, am I truly still in tune with the heart of the Father? Am I still really in tune with what God wants for my life? Or have I been distracted? Am I praying as much as I should? Or as much as I know God expects from me? Am I reading the Word of God as much as I should? Am I reflecting Jesus as well as He has sent me to do? Am I still in line with that purpose? Am I loving people, or am I just sitting at home and hopelessly waiting for things to change? That's not our life, saints. It's not our life. We were meant to live for purpose. We were not meant to wait for answers. We were meant to be the answer. And I want to challenge you, regain your focus. Change your input, change your output. Renew your mind, transform your life, so that you may live in the abundance of life, full of life and peace. And then God will be pleased by your life. I want to pray with you if you're saying, look, I need prayer. I need to refocus. I need to gain back my focus. I need to regain my strength and my, I know I can be more effective than I am right now. So I want to pray with you. And I believe all of us have stuff that we can reevaluate and shift around so that we can realign our focus. We need to change a couple of things that have been getting some preference in our input that needs to go away, so that we can rewire our software, so that we can put different stuff, because your brain, your mind is like your hard drive. It runs the software that's in it. So if you put the right thing, you'll get the right results. But if you put the wrong things, it won't perform to its best ability. It will be full of viruses and it won't satisfy its purpose. So if you can change the software, if you can take care of your software by downloading the right things, then you won't have a problem with your life. You won't have a problem with everything else. You won't have problems with functionality. You'll begin to see yourself walking in the fruits of the Spirit. You'll begin to see yourself practicing the gifts of the Spirit, healing the sick, healing the blind eyes, prophesying, speaking in tongues. You'll begin to see those things happening in your life because you've just changed your focus. You've narrowed things down. You've changed your input. You've focused things up. You've refused the distraction from the enemy. And listen, the challenge of distraction is an ongoing battle. The devil is not going to stop trying to distract you through social media, through any other platforms that are there, especially right now when all you can do is the internet. So you got to really be careful that you don't lose focus, that you're not distracted. You don't probably have people to watch over you as you did before, and you're on your own. Don't lose focus. Don't lose focus. Watch your mind. So I want to pray with you today. Lord Jesus, help us, Lord, help us to place our minds on the right thing, your word. Lord, I pray that you help each person right now that just needs to shift things around so that you can have preeminence in their lives. I pray, oh God, that you help each and every person to live differently from this day onwards. We know, Lord God, that our life are results of our thinking. So I pray, help us to change our thinking. Amen. Remember that your life is a reflection of your thinking. You want a better life? Find better thinking or tweak your thinking. I don't want this to just be another word, but I really want you to start practicing this. So after this sermon, after watching this, or after hearing this, make sure, even if you have to take a piece of paper and start writing down things that are you going to start being disciplined about. This is what I'm going to do, and this is what I'm not going to do. And you start protecting that mind. There will be temptations every now and again to bring back some of the things that you're going to be omitting. But remember, focus, focus, focus. So whenever you feel yourself losing off track, then you go back. You go back to the drawing board. Go back to the piece of paper and say, hey, this thing is out. This thing is out. I need to protect my software, because my life will be a result of how well my software runs. Well, we're going to pray, and please make sure that you get the most out of this series, as we're going to be running it for the next couple of weeks, because by the time we finish with it, I want to hear your feedback on what you think has changed in your life. I want to hear how you have improved or how you have grew simply by changing your thinking. Change your input, change your output. If I were to simplify today's message, it would be two things. What do you mind, right? What do you think about? Number two, change your input, change your output. We love you. God bless you. Have a great week. Spend time with God. Spend time with the Word. And make sure that every day you are getting closer and closer to becoming more like Jesus. Take care. God bless. Thank you. The King is in the room. Your healer's in the room. Your savior's in the room. Your provider's in the room. Your redeemer's in the room. Your champion's in the room. He's in this room.